Assalamu alaikum, and I'm pleased to be with you today, and I'm grateful to IIUM leadership for inviting me to this important gathering. My only regret that Dr. Abdelhamid is not with us at this point. I hope he will get better soon, and we'll see him again in his energetic spirit. Amen. But let me share with you in these few moments some of my experiences with Dr. Abdelhamid and his impression on me. In fact, I got to know Dr. Abdelhamid first during one of the AM the American Muslim Social Scientist, AMSA, in 1987. That conference was held in ISNA headquarters, and Dr. Abdelhamid was then the president of the association, and I was a master's student. And that event was, in fact, my first academic participation in any academic conference. Of course, I knew Allah yarhamhu, Dr. Jamal and Dr. Hisham before from ISNAM activities, but I had no previous encounter with Dr. Abdelhamid. In fact, during that conference, Dr. Hisham took me aside with Dr. Jamal and said, "Well, we'd like you to be the discussant of a paper he presented, and you should be critical." And this really says a lot about the commanding presence of Dr. Abdelhamid. The first thing when you meet with him, he has a commanding presence. You feel that his assertiveness, his confidence, and his clarity of views and visions immediately jump out to anyone who meet with him, particularly the first time, but I think that continues with many people around him. So that was our first encounter. And then we met sporadically. I mean, we didn't meet a lot during those years between 87 or 1987 till 92, when I was invited to come to IIUM. I was given a position as assistant professor. I was newly graduate. And when I looked at the salary, I said, well, probably, I sent a letter of to the Dr. Abdelhamid saying, well, I think probably I will find it challenging to be there given the amount given to assistant professors. Maybe I'll join later, but he insisted. He said, no, everything here is affordable, and come. And indeed I came. I never regretted it. It was, one of the formative times of my life where I learned a lot, being with a number of many, in fact, many faculties who were committed to making something about enhancing the ability of Muslims to produce their own knowledge and not be dependent on imported knowledge from the West. I spent, of course, during that time, since between 1992 and 1999, I had many occasions to interact with him in different contexts, including personal as well as professional. And I learned a lot about Dr. Abdelhamid that I never knew before. Now, if you ask me to describe Dr. Abdelhamid in one sentence, I would say he is a man who fell in love with the Ummah early in his life, and he never repented. I mean, his life was around the notion of the Ummah, and particularly about the mission of reforming Muslim education. This was his passion. And he is a man of passion. For people who don't know him very well, he might seem a bit dispassionate. He speaks with a lot of calm. But really, he has a deep passion for what he does. And I guess that's what Dr. Kamal referred to. I mean, he would wake up early in the morning thinking about how to advance this cause, reforming Muslim education, and he will spend the whole day up until he goes to bed. In fact, maybe many people don't know, when he go back, you know, to home, this is not the end of his work. You know, many meetings will take place at his residence, and any guest of the university he would invite will be in at his dinner in the evening at his home. So all his life really evolved around that passion. Now, how that passion emerged, probably it's difficult for me to tell. But what I can tell you is that Dr. Abdulhamid graduated from the University of Pennsylvania in 1973. And in Pennsylvania, where he got to know Dr. Ismail Farouqi, and then got to know also many members of the Islamization of knowledge family, if I could put it this way. He got to know them there. And together, they developed this project that we called for a long time and probably still used today in IIUM, Islamization of Knowledge Project. And the paper that was written by Dr. Ismail Farouqi, many people, I was one of those who thought that this was Ismail Farouqi ideas. I came to know that a lot of those ideas were Dr. Abdulhamid's ideas as well. And he once, you know, made a remark when I referred to that pamphlet as pamphlet by Dr. Ismail. He said, "Well, I participated in that preparation of that document." And well, I was initially not sure, but really, I came to know that really these are his ideas. Islamization of knowledge is his project, and probably the name itself might have contributed a lot to that name. So maybe what I should do now is to say a few things about his personality. I would like to highlight three qualities that Dr. Abdulhamid has that are really very central to his influence and his contribution. He is insightful. I think Dr. Yaqub referred to that. He has a deep insight. He a good observant, he good listener, and he has a clarity of vision. His vision about what is needed and what has to be done is very clear, and it is really based on a very pure intuition. I mean, he is not bothered by all this complexity of thoughts that he would feel will dilute the importance of the issue, but to try to present his ideas in the most simple way that go directly to the mind and to the heart. This is his gift, very insightful. I remember one time he was mentioning to me something about his father, that his father was, and of course, this told me about a lot about his ability to come to reflect on event and issues. He said his father used to smoke, but every time he would smoke this argila, you know, this shisha, he would tell the children that, well, this is very bad to him because he has a cough and it's not good for the health, and he told me, "I hated these things because of the way my father was describing it. I never even thought to try it." So this gives you the type of observation and keen observation to be able to draw to drive and to analyze things around him. He is focused, and that's really part of being passionate about what he wanna do, about what is his life all about. He's very focused, and is his main focus, as we all know, called the standardization of knowledge. This project that he almost single-handedly at one point pushed, I tried to push back against this idea to say, well, let us change that title. It's confusing people, but he would not take those suggestions. He was very sure that this has to be named this way. So he's focused. He focused all his energy on the task at hand. And unlike many intellectuals and professors, he is very attentive to details. He cares about details and he remembers things and asks. I worked with him and I occasionally would find him calling me and ask about something we spoke about maybe 2 weeks ago and asking, has that been done? So he, despite all the busy schedule he has, still would keep in his mind certain key issues and follow up to make sure that things are moving in the right direction. Finally, he is an assertive person. I mean, he really, as I said, he has a commanding presence. And while he is patient, while he listens, but he always put his ideas forcefully and defend them to the end. And so this character of his, I think, is unmistakable. Probably anyone who worked with him, he would have sensed this strength of opinion and of clarity of his ideas and his insistence on going through that route. Of course, I mean, in terms of his attentiveness, I think Dr. Kamal mentioned his focus on the campus. I would say that he was really partner with the designer in putting together this design of the campus. He was discussing with all the architects details. He has a particular view about how the students should live together, how to be together, but there is privacy and separateness at the same time. He would repeat this story many times to his visitors because it was really his idea. The whole outlook of the campus was also his idea. He not only followed the design, but the implementation. So that kind of person that Dr. Hamid is. So his assertiveness, let me say something about his assertiveness. So he has a strong point. He presented with full force, but he is fair and engaged. So he does not dismiss, you can push back against him, and he would not really try to cut off the discussion. He would listen back and come back at you. So he's engaging, he's fair in his dealing, and he's patient. I mean, he can take even criticism. Not many people in our part of the world, particularly in position of authority, can take criticism, but he does. And I have a lot of episode with him on that front, and he was always open. He never tried to sort of retaliate against criticism. He would welcome it as long as it is with good spirit and with goodwill. And he has this intuition to be able to sense things even from the first look. He is a very intuitive person. I guess this is basically what I wanted to share with you. I haven't met Dr. Abdul Hamid for the last probably 20 years, ever since he left the United States after 2001. after 9/11. I never had the opportunity to meet with him. I have all the respect for him, and I wish him the best. I wish him good health, and we wish his family also good time with him. And I really hope that I will have the chance to see him one more time. Because my stay in IIUM was a very special period of my life, and without his insistence and assertiveness, probably I would have said no. But he continued to try to persuade me, and as I said, I had no regrets despite any difficulties I encountered there. But it was a very rewarding experience. And of course, part of that reward, the fact that I always felt at home when I was in Malaysia. I never felt to be a foreigner. I always felt part of the country. This is my home. This is my country. These are my people who I'm working with. And I conclude with again thanking the university, Dr. Razak, also the current rector, for blessing this gathering. And I hope we will see another one maybe in person after you deal with this pandemic period of challenges. Hopefully maybe next year we could have an occasion, and let us pray that Allah give Dr. Hamid the health so we can see him again back at IIUM. Thank you.
Ameen.